Good evening. I'm Judy Koch. I'm the Richard and Elizabeth Curry Chief of Public Programming and Learning here at the AGO. And in the Public Programming and Learning Division, we foster creativity, learning, and dialogue through experience with art and ideas. To that end, we present talks, special events, performances, and studio art programs for over 250,000 people a year. We acknowledge you here tonight. We welcome you here tonight, acknowledging the Indigenous peoples of Ontario whose rich history on this land stretches back for many thousands of years. We're very delighted to welcome Edmund de Waal, who traveled all the way from London, England, to launch the Canadian edition of his newest book, The White Road. Our special thanks go to our collaborators for tonight's event, Penguin Random House, Canada, and the Gardner Museum. So thank you. Edmund de Waal is one of the world's leading ceramist artists, and his porcelain is held in many major museum collections. As well, his best-selling memoir, The Hair with the Amber Eyes, has been published in 30 languages and won the Costa Biography Award and the Ondaatje Prize, and happens to be one of my favorite books. De Waal was recently awarded the prestigious Wyndham Campbell Prize for Nonfiction, given annually by Yale University for an outstanding piece of nonfiction writing. Following Edmund's talk this evening, we will have time for some questions from the audience, and then there will be a book signing. So stay tuned for the rest of the evening, and now please join me in welcoming Edmund de Waal.
Well, this is absolutely terrifying. I wasn't promised 400 people. They said it would be a small gathering. Thanks. It's a huge, huge pleasure, as well as being a scary pleasure, to stand here with a new journey. It's a journey that's been a very long time in coming for me. It's been a journey that I started as a child. I made my first pot when I was 5 years old. I persuaded my dad, who was a clergyman, to take me to an evening class. And I sat down at a wheel in a basement. For some reason, they always think potters should be in basements. It's a very mysterious cultural mistake across all continents. And there was an electric wheel and clay, and I sat down and I made a perfectly dreadful pot. But it was mine. And there was something about this experience of having clay in my hands, of this extraordinary fugitive experience of something changing with me and despite me, that hooked me. And the next week I went back, and the next week the amiable teacher, ceramics teachers are always amiable, said to me, "What color, dear, do you want your pot? There are all this glazes here, a whole spectrum, rainbows of all different kinds of colors." And I said, "White." And I'm now 51, and I still make white pots. And this is my question. What is this thing of whiteness? What is it to make a life out of white objects, to return again and again and again to this experience of trying to make something in the world out of this tractable, beautiful, extraordinary material of clay? To still the world a little, to make a volume or a space which is a vessel and put it down in the world. What is this thing of whiteness? The great difficult question at the heart of that great book of obsession, Moby Dick. Now, I do obsession. That's why, as I moved towards my midlife crisis, I said to myself that I would take myself on a journey, a pilgrimage of sorts, a kind of paying of dues to those people who have made porcelain before me, to those people who have used it, and those people who have questioned it and reinvented it and reinvigorated it. Those people for whom porcelain, like me, is a query about the world. So, this is my world. This is my starting point. It's a very modest, if beautiful, space to make pots. It's a little monastic, and we may come back to that. And at the other side of the studio, high up, this is not what it looks like. It's far messier than this. This has been scrubbed up by some journalist. Looks totally ersatz. But it is a room of books. And it's a book room, and it's a shard room. It's full of objects from journeys alongside all my books. And because I am still basically channeling a five-year-old who goes down to make pots, I write on my walls, my white walls. And I write over years and try and work out where my journey is going to take me. And so I write a list of places for pilgrimage, and it goes London, you can't read it, but I can read it, London, Plymouth, Venice, Dresden, Cornwall, Stoke-on-Trent, Jingdezhen, the city of porcelain in China, Istanbul, Dublin, North Carolina, Beijing, Alach, West Norwood. West Norwood is my dull suburb where I make pots. In London, and then Rome crossed out. I didn't get to Rome. And then a great list of people. And then if you saw my wall of scribbles, you'd see lists and lists of books to buy. Always buy books. They help. Where do I go first? I go to China. I go to the place where porcelain began 1,000 years ago, the hills around Jingdezhen, a hot, humid city encased in green, a city where in the late Tang Dynasty, they worked out this extraordinary thing that if you bring two different kinds of white earth together, porcelain stone and porcelain clay, you can make a material which is so light that it lifts into your hands when you pick it up, that is so fine then when you lift it up, light comes through it, that is somewhere between clay and glass, which is the whitest thing in the world. And so I go to my first white hill, and I decide I need a guide. And my first guide, my first avatar, the first person I fall in love with and adopt for my journey, is a French Jesuit. Always fall in love with Jesuits. They're very good at lists. They're very, very exacting. They write good letters. They're good at discipline, our Jesuits. So my first guide to my first white hill is a Frenchman, a young Frenchman, Père d'Entrecolle, born in Limoges, the great place of porcelain, as it happens, who's sent off at 20, 7 months. It takes him on a boat to China. It's the end of the 17th century, and he's sent deep into exile, deep into China, to convert the Chinese and to write letters home about everything he sees. And where does he go? He's sent to Jingdezhen. He's sent to the city. And because he's someone who listens, because he's someone who enjoys people. He makes friends with potters. He walks the streets of Jingdezhen and he notices things. He talks to everyone and he writes letters home. So I take a photocopy of these wonderful French letters under my arm and I set off for Jingdezhen to my first hill. And there on my first morning, I go up the green hill and I look down under my feet with my guide, and there is a Song dynasty fragment of a porcelain bowl under my feet, and I'm speechless. It's an epiphany. It's the best moment of my life. And I turn round and my driver and my guide are laughing at me because the whole bloody hillside is full of broken pots. It's a landscape of brokenness. It's a whole culture, 1,000 years of these, of broken pots. The last time I came to Toronto, I brought a netsuke in my pocket and I handed it round. And you know, at the end of the evening, I got it back. So actually, this evening, I brought 2,000-year-old fragments. And the thing about shards, the thing about this experience of being on this hillside with this extraordinary crunch of porcelain under my feet is that I know what it meant, because everything that happens with porcelain is about things going wrong. It's the most extraordinary material, because the DNA of porcelain says that when you compound the clay, you bring these two white earths together to make porcelain, it goes wrong, it's contaminated, something gets into it. And then you try and make it, this paste, this extraordinary material, and it goes wrong in your hands, it warps, it moves like an Art Deco figure, and then finally you've made a pot and you put it in the kiln, and that's where the trouble starts. Because when you have heat, when you find these pots in your hand, you'll see that one of them, two kinds of bowls, they are has fused together. The other one has been fired too low and it's fractured. They are every single thing that can go wrong in the world happens around porcelain. And that's what it is to make your life from porcelain. And in these hills, they found the clay. And I went and found a mine and climbed into this crevice, this extraordinary, dark, damp place where the clay came out. And it was my first hill. And down the hill from this extraordinary landscape came people for 1,000 years carrying this clay down to the river and into boats. And the boats went all the way down to this city of porcelain, where the banks of the river are 1,000 years of shards. This is a series of photographs from 1920. But this is what you still see in this extraordinary city. It's a city where a poet in the 14th century said, "The day and the night are one. There are so many kilns in the city that it's like looking down into a dragon's mouth, that the firings of the kilns make the earth and the sky as red as fire." It's a city where every single alleyway is filled with people making pots. People grinding cobalt, that toxic, beautiful oxide which turns the world blue, which makes storytelling with ceramics possible. All those stories of blue and white happen here in Jingdezhen. Do you know, I'm going to have to speed up, otherwise we're going to be here for 1,000 years. And do you know, as I walk around the city with Père d'Entrecôte, I'm amazed because there are now railway tracks, but the train comes through once a day, and it's the only clear space in the city. So at 5 minutes before the train comes, everyone moves their pots off the railway tracks. And he talked about hearing the extraordinary cries of people wheeling barrow loads of porcelain through the streets. And there they are, wheeling their barrow loads of porcelain through the streets. And they're not tarmacked streets either. I watched this man and I felt that my heart was going to stop. And you look right and you look left, and everywhere people are making pots. These are children making pots. And I ask them how much they're paid for these extraordinary objects which go off to be in the atriums of Dubai hotels. And they said, enough for cigarettes and my mobile phone. Nothing. And you look again, and you look more closely, and what you see is dust. You see that everyone who's working with this porcelain is ankle deep in white dust. Because the other thing about porcelain, the other extraordinary thing about porcelain, is not only does it go wrong, but every time you touch this extraordinary white material, when you make it, there is a film, a haze of white silica dust that leaves the pot and enters your lungs. That's a different kind of white road. Seeing these children, seeing these men making pots in these factories, took me back to the very first day of my apprenticeship when I was 17, 35 years ago, when the man I was apprenticed to gave me a broom at the end of the day, and my first job was to sweep all the silica dust up into a great cloud, wait 5 minutes, and sweep again. That's what pottery does. It enters your lungs. And what is all this for? It's for this. It's for extraordinarily beautiful objects. Objects which are the purest, whitest, most extraordinary things in the world. There's nothing whiter than this. This is my first white object in the world, my first object in the book that I adopt. It's a monk's cap ewer. It's used for a Buddhist ceremony of purification. And it was commissioned by one of the most terrible emperors ever in the Ming Dynasty, the man called Yongle, a great and terrifying figure who murders whole sections of the population of his cities to gain power, but loves porcelain, who destroys whole cities, but wants to wash his hands from very beautiful white wares. This is the first time that obsession with purity, the danger of white, comes into my story. Because this is the man who achieves the throne by murdering every single member of his family and then builds a porcelain pagoda in commemoration of them. The biggest porcelain object in the world, 275 feet high, filled with white lamps every night, so that the whole of the city of Nanjing, you could see a white glowing porcelain object in commemoration of all the people he'd killed. What do you think about white? What is this thing of whiteness? Why porcelain? And this great pagoda, everyone comes to see it. And when I mean everyone, I mean Jesuits, because this is the first object that my Jesuit, Père d'Entrecôte, sees, and he writes a letter home. And in his letter, he says, I found the secret of porcelain. I have cracked the arcanum. I can tell you how this great mysterious material is made. Now in Europe, you will be able to make it. And do you know what they do in China? They make pagodas out of porcelain. Listen, he says in his letters, this is what is possible with porcelain. And in Versailles, where his letters are opened and read, a young king, Louis XIV, who has appetites for all kinds of splendid things, reads about this Chinese emperor and decides that he too needs his own porcelain building and builds a Trianon de Porcelaine, the first porcelain building in Europe. But he can't make porcelain, so it's Delftware and it leaks. It's dreadful. It's full of holes. The ceilings are chinoiserie. He makes love to his mistress in a damp room surrounded by faux porcelain. But everyone comes to Versailles. And this is my second avatar, my second person I fall in love with. And I promise you, there are very odd people in this book. They're really quite disturbingly odd, but we won't go there. The second person, unlikely person I fall in love with, and it really is very strange, is a German mathematician. Now, you wouldn't think that someone in a wig like this could become so totally enrapturing, but I've spent a very, very long time with this man. And I'm a great believer that when you do research, you have to do it properly. You can't do it over the internet. That's a totally phony, fake, throw away the books that are done by people with laptops. You actually have to go to places and have to find people and bring them back to life. And the only way you can do that is by reading everything they've written and going to the place they were born and going on the travels with them. And this young man, an impoverished aristocrat in the middle of nowhere, a German aristocrat, discovers that he loves mathematics. He loves discovering that actually the world can be brought into abstraction and put back together again. And because my wife isn't here, I can tell you that I crazily, in the middle of the night, bought an incredibly expensive book, which is his mathematical theories in Latin, from a Dutch antiquarian bookseller for a ridiculous amount of money because I had to have it in my hands. And I can't read it, it's in Latin. And I can't understand the maths, but it's beautiful. And he was 18 when he did this. And it's wonderful. And my whole Canadian advance went on this book. But there you go. But he takes mathematics and he thinks that actually what he's going to do is to go around Europe. He's going to go on his Wanderjahre, his gap year. He's going to go and sit at the feet of people he admires. And he chooses very well, does the Count Czernhaus. Because the first person he goes to is Spinoza. And Spinoza teaches him how to think. And Spinoza teaches him how to grind lenses. Because Spinoza makes lenses for a living. And Spinoza says, go and see Newton. And Newton sketches for him how light bends and refracts. And Newton says, go and see Leibniz in Paris. So he goes to see Leibniz, and Leibniz introduces him to the burning lens, to the idea that with a lens, light comes through and refracts, but light also intensifies and burns, and that you can put materials down in front of this light and strange alchemical things happen. The world is not compounded, it's taken apart. You can ask questions of the material world. And because Czernhaus thinks cleverly, he makes lenses, and he makes this beautiful lens. It's as tall as me. It's the most beautiful thing in the world. It's in Dresden. You have to take the plane from Toronto now to Dresden. You have to go into the extraordinary collections of scientific instruments there and see this amazing lens. It's like Alice in Wonderland. You look into it and everything changes. Everything changes. And so this young, impoverished man with his lenses starts to think, what can I do with light? What am I going to do? What's my question? And because he's been to Versailles and seen the damp love palace of the Sun King, he thinks, who has the most money? Who has the most desire for porcelain in Europe? So he goes to Dresden, where the young Augustus the Strong, Elector of Saxony, is sitting in his palaces, which are all gold. And Augustus the Strong has, he says, porcelain Krankenheit, the sickness of porcelain. He says it's worse than the sickness for oranges. And this is a man who builds 17 orangeries for his orange trees. When he became elector, this incredible rich kingdom that he inherits, he has 112 pieces of porcelain in his treasury. When he dies, he has 39,742 pieces of porcelain. He is the man of appetite. 600 illegitimate children as part of his story, and horses and gold and palaces and porcelain. He loves porcelain so much that he says in a letter that he wants to send a boat, his own boat, down the Elbe, all the way to the North Sea, all the way around the world, all the way to Canton to pick up his own cargoes of porcelain. He doesn't want to buy it. He wants to own it all. But he can't make it. No one in Europe can make porcelain. No one can make enough. It's no good sending someone to Amsterdam to buy 100 pieces of Chinese porcelain. He wants the lot. And that's where Czernhaus comes in. Czernhaus arrives and says to Augustus, I can do it. But he can't. There's something missing. He can do the abstraction, but he can't do the feeling. And this is where the story gets complicated, more complicated, because it's alchemy. Because a young man in Berlin has said that he has found the secret of the Philosopher's Stone. He's turned lead to gold. A young man called Bertger, a show-off, a know-all, 17 years old, throwing different materials together in a darkened room and impressing everyone. And Augustus has captured him and brought him to Dresden. Now this, I hate this man. I absolutely, everything I dislike is, it's not just the fact that he's, I think the open shirt is a bit much for me. But this ridiculous picture, which is in a castle in Meissen, actually tells you enough about Bertger. He is, admittedly, he was imprisoned for 7 years, I mean, in this castle. I mean, give him some credit for being miserable, but actually he is an absolutely appalling man. This is where he's imprisoned. He's imprisoned. I mean, you know, he really was, he had a reasonably rough patch in Meissen. He was imprisoned here and told to that he would only be unlocked, released, if he discovered gold or porcelain. So there was a certain element of tension in his life. But if you spend as much time as I have reading his appalling, driveling, complaining letters, there are 7 volumes of these letters, then you would dislike him as much as I did. But what he does is he's locked up and told to produce porcelain. And he and Czernhaus together bring together their knowledge. They bring together people and materials. And after 7 years, they make black porcelain. It's the wrong color. But when they know this, they know that they can bring together materials and actually make something which rings true, which when you tap it, has that extraordinary sound, which goes on and on and on. And there is this amazing, I could just show you archival things for hours, so just tough. You know, this is, you're gonna learn a lot tonight. This is the kiln notes. This is the thing that they write an hour after they've opened the kiln. And if you look down to number 5, and also it's interesting because it's actually, because they're so terrified that their secrets are going to be discovered, it's in Latin and in a kind of arcanists, an alchemical kind of code. But number 5 of this particular thing where they've tried different clays together, it says, Optime album et pellucidum. Number 5 is the best white, and it's pellucidum, it's translucent. They've actually done it. They've made white porcelain in Europe. They've cracked the Arcanum. They've done it. It's an incredible moment. And there's this letter of huge tenderness from Chernhaus, who spent at this moment 28 years from his first visit to Newton to holding this cup in his hands. And he says it's like a narcissus. And at that moment, you see the tenderness, this extraordinary feeling. I mean, you hear Narcissus and you smell it, but you hear that extraordinary moment of delicacy, of lostness, of something which is there and gone, that kind of fragility. It's like a Narcissus. And it's there. And 2 days later, Chernhaus dies. And all his books are gone, and all his notes are gone. And Bertger goes to the king and says, I have discovered European porcelain. And Bertger is released, and he becomes a count, and is given a house in Dresden, and becomes the father of European porcelain. Damn it. And on the base of all these cups, all these plates, all this extraordinary stuff that starts to be made in Meissen, all this great history of porcelain that begins here in Saxony with Augustus the Strong, this ridiculous man, this man of appetite, with this sickness for porcelain, has the crossed swords in cobalt, the first porcelain cipher. On the base, pick up your Meissen cup, turn it over, and look at those swaggeredly rapiers on the base. And Meissen becomes this. Everything turns gold. There's a moment early on in my book when I say, it's not as if I like all porcelain. I don't want to be the poster boy for porcelain, the cheerleader for porcelain. I pick up a Meissen bowl that belonged to my Viennese grandmother, which is worth a ridiculous amount of money, and it's full of images of cut pears and plums, and it's horrible. And I say, this is passive-aggressive porcelain, and I hate it. And this is what Meissen becomes. Where is the white here? It's finding something and losing it in the moment of its discovery. But that's my second white hill. The first is Jingdeden, the second is Meissen. And for my third white hill, I come home. My third white hill takes us to Plymouth. And it takes me in to the beginning of the 18th century to a young Quaker chemist called William Cookworthy. So my third unlikely person to fall in love with is a Quaker. Now, the only thing that everyone knows about Quakers is that they're silent. But they're not. They're very, very talkative indeed. They're very good at letters, and they're very good at writing about silence and white at length. And my Quaker chemist, William Cookworthy, learns how to compound the natural world. He looks at materials, he looks at plants, and as a young, impoverished man, he goes down to Plymouth to become an apothecary all by himself. And Plymouth, as many of you will know, is the dampest place in the world. It's a place, according to Mr. Cookworthy's neighbour, who has the first barometer in England, where there are seven different kinds of rain every day. So I read this record and can work out just how damp William Cookworthy is. For 45 years, he spends trying to find porcelain. And Cookworthy, who looks so dour and so serious, is a man of great humor. He's a man who loves walking. And he walks out into the Devon and Cornwall countryside, and he sees a landscape of mining, of people digging up materials. This is a great early map of the geology of Devon and Cornwall. It's a beautiful, it's a color field of geology. And he sees that wherever he's looking, that people are digging things up. And he talks to people. He talks to people mending roads and people side of the road, and he brings things back to his modest apothecary's shop in Plymouth. And because there's nothing to do in Plymouth, he reads every night, and he reads avidly, and he reads the letters of Père d'Entrecolle from Jingdezhen about the white clays of Jingdezhen, and he thinks that possibly, just possibly, some of the clay on his boots might have some kind of other life. So he walks up this hill, my third white hill, Tregoning Hill. This is a beautiful day of pilgrimage for me. Rather embarrassingly, I took an old pot of William Cookworthy up this hill and buried it at the top of the hill. I shouldn't have told you that. But he comes back from this hill, and he makes notes, and he builds a very small kiln in the back of his garden. And with his brother, he starts to do something. He says he's on the quest, on the journey towards the idea of perfect porcelain. He wants to be the first Englishman to get porcelain made. And he's going to do it. And movingly, I was in the archives in Devizes, which is nowhere. And I open a letter for the first time in 170 years, and out for shards of porcelain, the broken bits of porcelain. I hope my bits of porcelain are still going around these nice Toronto people. But out of this envelope fall these broken bits of porcelain, and it shows that he's almost there. It's almost there. And it takes him 40 years. It takes him 40 years from reading those letters, from his first forays into the damp English countryside, before he opens a kiln and he takes out the first piece of English porcelain on March the 14th, 1768. And on the base is CF, Cookworthy Feck It, Cookworthy Made It. And when you turn it round, there are the arms of Plymouth, the coats of arms in Plymouth, in terrible cobalt. and it's a really bad bit of decoration, and the cobalt has run, and when you pick it up, it weighs a ton. And do you know what it is? It's a Devon tankard, an ale tankard. It weighs a ridiculous amount, and it's already out of date. The first piece of English porcelain. What's not to like about that? But he's done it. He's done it all by himself. And so he sets up his own factory on the docks in Plymouth, and he makes tankards, and he makes little models of Devonian cows, which look like they could barely get up. They're so plump and so badly made. And he tries to get his manufactory off the ground, selling these things to the people who don't want English porcelain. And then he goes back every night and sits in his chair and reads scripture because he is a Quaker. And then he makes a terrible, terrible error. In a moment of extraordinary hubris, he decides that he's going to patent this amazing discovery of English porcelain. And as soon as he sets out a patent, and it's all there in Stationer's Hall for everyone to see it, all the way down from Stoke-on-Chant, the beady eye of Josiah Wedgwood falls on my Quaker, because Wedgwood, industrialist, entrepreneur, traveller, friend of the Royal Society, sponsor of Captain Cook, commissioner of Stubbs and Reynolds, friend of everyone, the maker of dinner services for Catherine the Great, sees a Quaker apothecary daring to patent porcelain and decides to destroy him. And he does. So Captain Cook is sent to Australia with instructions by Wedgwood to bring back white clay. And Josiah Wedgwood goes down to Cornwall and buys hillsides for his own use, now that he knows what to do with them. And Wedgwood looks around the world and decides that he is going to get the monopoly on all the white clay in the world. And he's heard a rumor that there is clay in Cherokee country, in Carolina. He's heard a rumor that there are white hills deep in the Appalachian Mountains. And because he's a man who has no sense of the impossible, he sends an adventurer, a ne'er-do-well, off all the way across the world to buy the hillside that belongs to the Cherokee Indians and strip their clay and bring it back to London. And because he goes, he sends someone to Cherokee country, so do I. So this is where my journey gets totally ridiculous. At this moment, it's 3 years of research. And I'm starting to write at night because I still have to make pots during the day. And then I discover this extraordinary story that the Cherokee Indians had white clay which they used for ritual purposes. It's very beautiful, it's micaceous, it has a silvery substance in it. It was so beautiful that they used to use it, mix it with water and put it on the insides of tents and small huts so that the whole of these, they glowed, porcelain rooms. And this man, this adventurer, Griffiths, is sent there to steal this clay. There's a record, this extraordinary record of him going. So I go and find this hillside of red earth, and there is the scar of white clay that's left. And I have it in my hands, this remaining white clay, the only clay that was left that belonged to the Cherokees. And in an act of I felt totally appropriate restitution. I took a very small piece of Wedgwood pottery from 1780 and put it back in the hillside. But what Wedgwood does, apart from owning everything, is to change the landscape. Because then there are not one or two or three white hills, but the whole of Cornwall is taken apart and mined for white clay. Hillsides disappear. Villages spring up with people making bricks of kaolin, just like they did in Jingdezhen. And Stoke-on-Trent becomes the second great industrial city of ceramics. And visitors say, like they did 600 years earlier in China, that there is no day and night, there's only smoke and fire. And visitors to Stoke-on-Trent look through doorways and they see children in ankle-deep in porcelain dust making white pots. It's a triumph for porcelain. It's the real burgeoning of white clay. And that's where I thought I'd finish my journey. I had my white hills. I had my three white pots. I thought that's enough of a pilgrimage. Time to write it up and send it off. But there's a great and profound untidiness about journeys. And one of the things I learned from my last journey, my journey into my family, is that you can't police storytelling. You can't make a story fit your preconception of what it holds. You can't pre-plan a journey. If you do, it's dead before you go, and you shouldn't go at all. So I thought my coda for my book, my leaving of my pilgrimage into whiteness, was Stoke-on-Trent. Was industrialization. And I was going to leave with a short chapter on my passion for modernism, for how much I love the pots of the 20th century, the industrial pots of the Bauhaus, those wonderful serial pots, those extraordinary rhythms of pots that mean a lot to me. My work is full of rhythms, and I find great joy in looking at massed porcelain, not just 18th century palaces of it, but stacks of industrial porcelain. This was meant to be my last image of my book. And because I can't sleep, partly because I've been drinking coffee for years and years and years and years, in the middle of the night, I'm looking up the factories where my favorite Bauhaus designer, Wilhelm Wagenfeld, worked. And I come across the name of a factory that I've never heard of. And I think, because I'm obsessive, I'm good on German factories of porcelain in the 20th century, but it's called Alac. So I buy a book. And it comes, it's a little book printed in the 60s, and I open it up and it says that Alac porcelain was made with a concentration of talent that is peculiar to the 20th century. And I open it, and it says that Alac porcelain was made in a suburb of Munich, that it was started by a group of Nazi artists to make white porcelain, because porcelain is the best Aryan material there is. It's the material of Germany. It's the DNA of our culture. and that these devout SS artists decided in the 30s to build a factory, and this is it. I went and found it. It's a derelict factory. I climbed a fence and climbed into this factory. It's a place of dereliction. But that in 1939, the market for this porcelain, this new white porcelain, is so great that Heinrich Himmler buys it and moves the factory to Dachau concentration camp because he says, "This is my favorite child. Porcelain is the thing I love most in the world, and this is the place it can be done best." And so in Dachau concentration camp, Allach porcelain is made, and it's so popular. It's so well made. It's so pure that as the Reich moves east, there are new shops for this porcelain in Warsaw, in all the new towns of the Reich. And in this factory of slave labor, Himmler comes, and Himmler brings his favored guests to choose porcelain. And they make beautiful white bowls. And they make figurines. They make images to give away to other people. This is Heydrich with his favorite portrait, with his favorite Allach piece. And here is Hitler examining the new pieces from a firing on his birthday. So I'm here in another kind of archive. And I'm faced with this question about this thing of whiteness. Because at this moment, this need for purity, this obsessive devotion to a material, seems to me an obsession that doesn't make sense. And the archivist, I spend days looking through letters and account books, and the archivist turns to me and says, "We've just been given a piece of Allach porcelain. Would you like to see it?" And they bring out one of those sort of plastic washing tubs, latticeware things, and it's just come in. It's wrapped in newspaper, and I unwrap it, and it's Bambi. It's an object of profound sentimentality, and I pick it up and turn it over, and it's Bambi, with the double runes of the SS turned into the Meissen mark, transposed into SS, transposed into Allach. And it's that moment, that matrix of obsession and whiteness and material, that totally takes me apart. What is this thing of whiteness? Why obsess? What does it mean? How can you bring it all together? Which shows you that you cannot end journeys where you want to end them. You just can't. There is a profound and disturbing quality, a kind of contingency about actually going out and not knowing what you're going to find. So what do you do with knowledge? I didn't want to go on a journey for solace. I don't believe in solace. I didn't go on a journey, a white road, a journey into obsession, to make myself feel better. I went to try and find out who I am and why I'm doing it. And what I do is to make work. I make books and I make pots. And the way I make things is to try and find a frame, a way of holding things in the world and it can be on shelves. This is a piece called Breath Turn. Or it can be underground. This is an archive I made for Cambridge. It's all the broken objects I could find. I made an archive. There was a very quarrelsome, annoying group of academics in Cambridge who wanted some art for their new building. So I gave them an archive, which they had to walk over on their way in to disagree with each other. Because archives are untidy. They're places where things are held together in difficult and challenging ways. These are things that are broken. These are shards as well as perfect pots. These are pots that are abandoned. Archives are places where the things that are most special and the things that you don't want to see are put away. And I find places which are above you. This is an installation I've made last year for a beautiful gallery by the sea called Turner Contemporary. Here we are in a museum with Turner below us. We shouldn't be listening here in the dark. We should be looking at Turner. This is in Margate, where Turner used to go and look at the weather. So they said to me in this beautiful new gallery, which is in the place where Turner used to paint, do something for us. So I said, I'll do something which is about the weather. So I call it atmosphere. And I put out mats so that people could lie and look at the clouds. And sometimes, even though it's Margate, the sun shone, which was pretty good. And I make things which are about music, things which are about trying to find the balance and rhythm, the caesura, the moments of picking something up, a theme, and putting it down. This is composition for three voices. This is a piece I've only just made. I've only just finished this. It's off to America next year. These are new works. I don't know what I'm doing, but I'm trying to make porcelain which has some kind of weight as well as some kind of lightness. And I'm trying to make things which actually have the quality of words. This is a piece called 10,000 Things for John Cage. It's 20 aluminium vitrines, each with one piece of Corten steel and three black pots. Because what it really is about, if I'm really honest, it's about poetry, and it's always been about poetry. And when I was coming to the end of this 5-year journey of obsession into whiteness, I was asked by a museum in Vienna to make a piece for them, for an extraordinary building on the Ringstrasse, a small temple, a small space on the Ringstrasse in Vienna. Now, I have problems with Vienna. What do I take to Vienna? What do I make for a place which is both home and not home? What do I take back to Vienna? So I take poetry. I make something which is called Lichtzwang, light duress. It's a poem by the extraordinary Romanian poet Paul Celan. Celan grows up in Romania. His parents are killed in the camps. He lives everywhere. He is homeless, and he writes poetry of unbelievable beauty. The beauty is shocking. It's more cry than exhalation. It's rhythmical and broken. He brings words together in new and difficult ways. And throughout his poems, there is whiteness, the whiteness of landscape, the whiteness of homelessness, the whiteness, he says, of my mother's hair. She would never see whiteness in her hair. And Lichtzwang, I put this piece up. It's 2 pages. It's a book in Vienna. and I write the poem on the wall. And for 9 months of the year in Vienna, this piece is there. And the door is open, and people come and go, and tramps go in when it's raining, and people bring their kids with their ice creams, and people go to see art, and a dance group make a very beautiful and not very good dance piece about it, and the critics hate it, but it's open. It's an open space with a poem about homelessness and white in Vienna. Because actually, that's really what it's about. It's about trying to start again with a white page or a lump of white clay and trying to make something which actually makes you want to stop and look and think and read and start again. Thank you. That's really nice of you. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Okay, thank you very much, Edmund. I think I speak for everyone when I say we're really glad you're an obsessive, and that introduction to the cutthroat world of porcelain was fascinating. We have about 20 minutes for questions. There are two microphones in the room.
There may be no questions, and everyone might want to go to the bar.
That could happen. But if you want to ask a question, just wave at us and I'll bring a mic over. Okay, I've got one in the front to start.
Hi, good evening.
Good evening.
Thank you for the talk.
Thank you.
This is less of a question and more of a compliment of a thank you. I'm a student next door in university studying painting, and as many other painting students would, there's a lot of ambition for self-expression. And I just really want to thank you today because your work to me, when I see your work for the first time, I learned that to pause, to look at things, it reminds me a lot of beauty, of poetry, and I just really want to thank you for that.
That's incredibly nice of you. Thank you so much. Thank you. That's it. I mean, really, we really should go to the bar now. Thank you.
My question is...
Sorry, I can't see. Where are you?
I'm right here.
You're there. Hello. Good evening.
Hi. Ever since I read your first book...
Yes.
I've been searching in vain, where can I see your pots?
Okay.
I've been to London.
Yes.
And every time, I can't...
Okay. Where can you see my pots? Okay. You can see my pots in the V&A. So you go into the Victoria and Albert Museum and you look up, and 100 feet above you, in a red ring, which is 130 feet in all the way around, are 450 pieces of my porcelain. And it's what they call a semi-permanent installation, in that they said, we can't be bothered to take it down for 50 years. So in the next 50 years, you're pretty safe if you go to the V&A to see it. Now, the other place you can go and see it is in January in Los Angeles, where all this new work is going to be. It's a huge exhibition. So that's my next big exhibition. Do you know, I'm very grand, I have a website. But thank you. Would you mind if I take my jacket off? That was a really big effort, that talk. It's Canada. I'm allowed to take a jacket off, aren't I? Yeah, thank you very much.
Can you...
That was exhausting. Right, okay, next question. Hello, good evening.
Can you speak about the dialogue that you're having at the moment at the Royal Academy in the library with objects of whiteness?
This is a joy. Okay, I've been asked to talk about a project I'm doing that is underway at the Royal Academy in London, in Piccadilly at the moment. It's an exhibition which is, with great ambition, called White. Actually, entre nous, what I really wanted to call it was, I wanted to call it The Nothing That Is, which is a beautiful line from Wallace Stevens. So I went to this meeting in the Royal Academy, and there were 17 people in suits, and I said, I've got the perfect title for this, The Nothing That Is. And all the marketing people went, oh God, no, you can't call an exhibition The Nothing That Is. We'll have to call it White. So I was outvoted. So my project, The Nothing That Is, at the Royal Academy, is all my favorite white things in the world. Because when I was doing this ridiculous journey, I had in my notebook, I kept a running list of all the things that in the best possible circumstance I would bring into a space. So in the library of the Royal Academy, which is a space that no one goes into, but is a silent space, I've put Romanesque sculpture, an ivory hare, a beautiful Mirandi, a Malevich, a Robert Ryman painting, a Sugimoto photograph, a Cy Twombly sculpture, a first edition of Moby Dick, Samuel Beckett, Wallace Stevens poems, Tristram Shandy opened at the White Chapter, early photographs, death masks, and I've taken away all the labels and printed a really beautiful hand list. So you can go in, find things, or not find things. And I went in there on Friday with a new friend, Eleanor Wachtel, who is a great, and I took her there. I'd never met her, but I talked to her on the phone, and I took her in, and it was meant to be silent. I said, Ellen, this is going to be a beautiful, spiritual, white experience. And the guard there, because everything's worth £1 million, the guard there was talking very, very loudly, and he was saying, warmer, 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 colder, colder, very cold. And there was this elderly lady who couldn't find things, and he was giving her... my beautiful moment of pure spiritual connection with Eleanor. There was this terribly jocular English guard saying, cooler, warmer, warmer, warmer. But if you're in London before January the 3rd, go and have a lovely, noisy time in the library.
Mr. de Waal, I was so happy to hear you speak of your work as being about poetry. As a reader of The White Road, what strikes me is how beautifully designed and typeset and composed the book is. For anyone who hasn't cracked the book open yet, it's exquisite, and there's a vision there and an integrity to it. And for me, it is a long, sustained prose poem. And there are many Canadian poets in the audience tonight. And could you tell us about the design and editorial process of the
book? I'm so happy to hear you. Thank you very, very much. Well, I wanted to make a white thing. You know, it's a thing. It's an object. I mean, texts are, of course, objects, just like poetry and sound and objecthood interweave all the time. So when I was designing the book, when I was thinking of the book, what I was trying to do, I'm going to bring a shard back onto the... What I tried to... It's a book in 66 chapters. And a lot of the chapters are fragments. There's a lot of... As you're suggesting, there's a lot of white space in the book. There are these sections of journeys, but there are also considerable areas of white space between the kinds of... between my writing. And what I was really trying to do was to make a book in which you could pause. So not only are there no colour photographs, because I detest colour photographs in a book that you need to read. What the hell are colour photographs doing in a book when you want to read it? So there are black and white photographs to keep you reading, but the whole pacing of the book, the pacing of the book is absolutely that. It is meant to be a poem. I'm so glad. And so I worked with a graphic designer called John Morgan, who is a great friend of mine, who does a lot of my of graphic design. We talk a lot. And he came up with this vision for how to set out the book. And, you know, my publisher's here in the audience, and the miraculous thing about being allowed to produce a book with that level of care is truly wonderful. And when you, if you get the book, when you, if you get the book, stroke the cover, because that's also been thought through. It has a particular tactility to it. So, you know, it's a marvelous thing to work with people who actually want to make beautiful books. And thank you. I'm terribly pleased.
I think that might be it.
Got time for one last question.
Two things. One, yes, thank you for the poetry, but also thank you for showing that people who work with their hands can be intelligent. There was a terrible review of one of your shows, and that said how unusual it was that potters had brains, and that you were extraordinary in that. And in fact, you are extraordinary in that. But so are most people who work with their hands who have their own intelligence. Thank you for putting that together in that way. I have one other question. Thank you. Two parts.
Yeah.
And you talked all about white, and then your last slides are black.
Yeah.
And
okay.
You didn't address
So two things that the intelligence of hands, the intelligence of the body, the intelligence of making has been under the pall of condescension. It's absurd. Things of huge power and incendiary interest and excitement have been made across millennia, and just they're disregarded and not taken with the care and the time and the imagination and the storytelling around them. And it's something that I feel so passionate about, that we should just take the objects which define being a human being much, much more seriously. So yes to that. And black pots, yes, black pots. Well, I don't know.
I think that's it.
Thank you so much. And may I have my shards back, please?
Yes, I was just going to say, if you are the person holding the shards, if you could please raise them and we will collect them for Edmund. So I don't see where the shards are. Oh, I see one. Okay, there's two. We have them. All right. Thank you so much for what a splendid evening and for sharing your obsession with us. And I'm sure you've created new obsessions here tonight in the audience. Thank you. And we will have a book signing at the back of the room. And thank you all for sharing this very special evening with us.